he came. When I'm sad, the dearest friend I ever had. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now. At his dear feet, just stumbly by, he'll save your soul and make you glad. The dearest friend I ever had, he saved my soul. Oh, bless his name. I'll never forget the day he came. He makes me glad when I'm sad. The dearest friend I ever had. The dearest friend I ever had.
They thought I forgot the words, but my mic cut off, so what happened? No, I'm just kidding. No. How's everybody? Jerry, you gonna pray for us before we get started? Amen. Come help us sing a little. Anybody that will. What are we doing now? Same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. You've been trying to feel the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. And if you feel lost, he's a way maker. And if you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker. Better life, there's a better life. You got pain, he's a pain taker. And if you feel lost, he's a way maker. And if you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker.
You believe it, you receive it. You can't feel it, somebody testify.
You got pain, he's a pain taker. And if you feel lost, he's a way maker. And if you need freedom to save it, he's a prison shaker. You got chains.
He's a chain banker.
If you need freedom, save it. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains.
He's a chain banker. If you got chains, he's a chain.
you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master.
For he knows your woes.
Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master.
It hit you without any warning. The storm of your life had begun. And seeing no hope in the distance, you're so frightened with no.
You prayed all night, 'cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. For he knows your woes. Lift your hands, it's your cries have awoken the Master.
Now you're up there worried that he's fast asleep. The winds are so deadly, the water's so deep. Try to be patient, 'cause soon he'll bring peace. Just one word from his voice.
You prayed all night, 'cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. For he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Child, your cries have awoken the Master.
Ask all the veterans to remain standing because we wanted to give them recognition and thank them for their service to this country and thank them for everything they've done, because we wouldn't have freedoms that we have today if not for the Lord and you guys and seeing this through. So we want to thank you guys for what you've done.
I appreciate our veterans, don't you?
Amen.
Got your Bibles, turn to Nehemiah chapter number 8. Wednesday, this coming Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we're not going to have service in here. We will be in the fellowship hall putting Thanksgiving boxes together to take and give out. Anybody that wants to come and help, come, and you can bring some food to go in them, whatever you want to do. But we'll have good fellowship, a good time, and we'll get all them ready. How many of you heard that? Amen.
I'll remember that.
Huh?
I said, how many will remember that?
Oh, I know.
I remember that.
Oh, to be young. Hopefully, Lord willing, maybe today and one more message, and we will be out of the book of Nehemiah, maybe two more. We're going to go to the last chapter. You ought to read that. You ought to read the whole book. And the Lord's sure been good to us. We won't be in Nehemiah very long today. We'll go ahead and mark Matthew chapter number 11 with your finger if you want to, or with something. And we'll be over there in a few minutes. How many of you enjoyed that Sunday school lesson this morning? It was mighty good. Mary and Martha was wore out from being caretakers. I asked a while back how many of you ever been a caretaker for somebody, and several raised their hand, and Miss Betty never been nothing more taxing on a human than being a caretaker. God honor it. Nehemiah chapter number 8, if you've got your Bible, stand to your feet for just a minute. I'm not sure how this is going to go. This is one of those I studied early yesterday morning. Well, I studied it all week, but then when I went back to it yesterday evening, I kind of wondered what I was thinking. Anybody ever done that with something? Brown, you ever get a thought on your mind, read it, and say, boy, this is going to be good? Then you look at it later and think, what was I thinking? Greg, how did that work? So we'll just see. Hope the Lord sends it out better than He put it, even better than He put it in. Let me read verse 6, and then you can be seated. We'll go to verse 12 maybe here in just a minute. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. And all the people answered, amen, amen. Would somebody say amen?
Amen.
I know during the music, a lot of times I hear a lot of amens. Went to a little Pentecostal church one night over in Avery County. Singers got up and sung, and the place was dead quiet. Preacher got up and said, open your Bibles, and the place went wild. So I don't know exactly how we're supposed to do it, but we're supposed to worship God the whole time. And we ought to worship Him for the Word of God for sure. People answered, amen, amen, with the lifting up of their hands. Amen. They hadn't been trained in this. They weren't taught to do this necessarily from a small age, but something just stirred up inside of them. They begin to say amen, and their hands begin to raise up in the air. They bow their heads and they begin to worship. They worship the Lord with their faces to the ground. Let's pray, Lord, we love You. Thank You. This morning for Your Spirit, for Your Word, God, for James's opening, Kevin's lesson, and everything that's tied together, and how You're going to tie the rest of it together, Lord, with Your Spirit. God, I pray over this congregation. There's people here that needs help in desperate need. God, I pray You'd use Your Word and Your Spirit together, God, to go out in this congregation and accomplish what we can't do on our own. Lord, we love You. Thank You for the cross. Thank You for loving us and being here today. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. We read Wednesday night how that they all the people gathered together in one accord. They all got together and they asked for the reading of the Word. And they called Ezra, and he came and he began to read. And the Bible said all that could hear and understand. Now, how many of you this morning, from small to older, can understand what I'm saying? Raise your hand if you can understand what I'm saying up here this morning. If you've got to understand it, if you know right from wrong, raise your hand.
Amen.
All right, a lot of accountability. Now in the room, you've acknowledged you're accountable. You understand. You can hear. So here it is. So they were all attentive. Ezra got up on a pulpit full of wood, and he opened the book in the sight of all the people. And he was above all the people. And Brown, that's when they begin to worship. And they begin to listen to the Word of God. And I talked Wednesday night only about the Word of God. And that's all I talked about. I didn't get into anything else but just the goodness of the Word of God. We're blessed today. I know we're excited. A lot of you are excited. The church is excited about what all's happened this week. We feel like our country might have took a step in the right direction. And we're praying that God will just begin to change things and move. And maybe taxes and groceries and things like that that hit everybody, that stuff will start to go down. But I'll tell you what's going to change the country, and it's only one thing, and that is the Word and the Spirit of God. That's the only thing that's going to change your home. It's the only thing going to change your community. It's the only thing going to change you personally. And it's the only thing that's going to help through eternity is the Word and the Spirit of God. Without the Word of God, none of this would matter. Amen. So these people got a hunger for the Word of God. They got a craving for it, and they couldn't even explain why. So they got them a man. And listen to this, and then we'll go to verse number 8, and Lord will help me in a few minutes. I want you to listen to what happened when the Word of God is read. So they read the book. They read in the book in the law of God distinctly. We're in chapter 8, verse 8 of Nehemiah. Distinctly, that means they read distinctly. They read, Doug, exactly what it said. They took it literal. They believed what it said and gave the sense. Now, ain't that amazing that they gave the sense? Has anybody ever read the Bible and said, that don't make sense? I was talking to a boy just the other day, and he's smarter than I am, and he began to talk about things. He said, we need to start bringing some things back, and he went to talking about the feasts and all this stuff, and my mind went to spinning. I didn't know what he was doing. By the time he was done, I felt so stupid, but I felt so glad that all I had to have was faith in the death, the burial, the resurrection, that I had called on His name and believed in Him and trusted in Him, and that is my eternal security. Security, amen. Because a lot of that stuff I'm not going to be able to figure out.
Amen.
But listen to what they caused the sense, and they caused them to understand the reading. That's what we need in churches today. We need teachers that'll get up in a pulpit, and teachers and preachers and people that'll get up in front of people and read the Word of God distinctly. Read it letter for letter, word for word, and explain what it means.
Amen.
Well, that's lacking. And listen, and Nehemiah, which is their Tirshatha, or their governor, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord. Mourn not or weep. I want you to listen to this. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. All the people wept. I'm going to stop right there for a minute, and I'm going to go back to that in a little while when we go to the book of Matthew, but I want you to listen to something. They were excited. They were wore out to begin with. They'd worked for 52 days, day and night, on a wall. The wall was completed. It was resurrected. The gates were put back, and they got a hunger, Alan. That working just wasn't enough. They saw the good hand of God is what they said. They saw the mighty hand of God do the work. They saw that, but something was still missing. They were on the outside looking in. They were inside the walls, but the city wasn't built. Listen to me this morning. If you came to church every Sunday and every Wednesday, if you did everything the church did, if you knew how to function as a church member, if you knew how to thrive out here and talk Bible to everybody, but you didn't really know, amen, the Word of God and what it meant, you just saw how everything worked, and that was it. If you sat in church, I've said it before, you will learn when to stand up. Well, here it's when the first key of the piano starts. You will learn when to say amen.
Amen.
You will learn when to raise your hand. You'll learn how to do a form of worship. You'll learn how to do all that. You'll learn all that good stuff. But without the Spirit of God, it's just an exercise.
Amen.
Amen. And these people found themselves in that place. They did the work. They saw that they were hungry. They were hungry for something else around. They just couldn't put their finger on. And they needed the Word of God. Amen. Are you all right this morning? But when they heard the Word of God, they began to do something strange. They began to weep when they heard the law. Now this is something that I don't see a lot in the house of God no more. I don't see a lot of people running to an altar being weeping. I don't see a lot of people come with tears running down their face and with their hearts broke. I don't see a lot of people that's sorry over their sins that they've walked in all week. I don't see a lot of people that's sad over how their life's not lining up with the Word of God and the Spirit of God. I don't see a lot of people, Denise, that are bothered when they come into the house of God. I don't even see people that are weeping coming into the house of God when they know their loved ones are lost and dying and going to hell. I don't see a lot of people come in with their hearts on their sleeves ready to do business with God. You just don't see that much no more, Miss Betty. People coming and hitting the altar, amen, with tears running down their eyes just over whatever is going on in their lives, amen. But these people, when they heard what happened, I can't imagine what all they must have read, but he might have got up and he might have opened the Bible and he might have read about the Ten Commandments and how the people couldn't keep them and they broke them and how they wandered in the wilderness, Doug, and how they fell and they'd fall and they might have begun to think, oh God, that's me. I can't do it. I can't walk in the way that I fell just like them. I'll mess up. I cannot do it. Amen. I remember when I first got saved, I would go to the jail every time they would let me. I'd be out mowing and the Spirit of God would hit me and I'd go in there and preach. And all the time, Brown, they'd say, well, I will when I'm ready, when I can live it, when I can do it. I'm just afraid I'll mess up. I'm just afraid I'll fail. Amen. That is salvation, honey. God knows you're going to mess up. He knows you're going to fail. Amen. After you're saved. Are you all right this morning? But when they heard the Word of God, they began to weep and mourn. Amen. It broke their hearts. It convicted them. When was the last time that a preacher or somebody got up and began to read the Scripture? And you wasn't sitting there thinking, preach to them. Preach to them. They need it. They need it. I went to a revival one time and there's about 20 preachers. The brother that sat all over the rows and I said, open your Bible. They begin to shout. I don't even know what they're shouting about. And they got quiet, but there's one boy that sit over here, a preacher, and every time I would say something, James, he'd say this right here, you're preaching to them now, you're preaching to them now. I thought, man, I preach to you sometime. When was the last time you come in the house of God and you was wanting the Word of God and the preacher to preach to you? You was wanting to get hit right between the eyes with it, right in the heart. You had a spiritual yearning in your heart for God to do something. And they begin to weep. And I imagine it was the whole crowd, the little ones, the big ones. You ever saw a small child weep under the anointing of God? It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. Listen to the Word of God. And I'll get over to Matthew in a minute and we'll go home. But I want you to listen to what he said. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Not the charismatic preaching, not the loud preaching, not the exciting preaching, not the boisterous preaching, not something, Miss Betty, not a sad story, but the Word of God. Then he said unto them, listen, go your way. Eat the fat and drink the sweet and sin portions. Man, that don't sound like something the Bible would say, does it? Life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. You mean God would want me to do that? God would want me to have life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. God would want me to be satisfied out here. God would want me to go to my house and say, I love my house. God would want me to sit down at my supper table and say, I love my supper table. God would want me to eat and talk to my wife and say, man, this is the best time ever. God would want me to get in my truck and say, I love my truck. God would want me to walk around my yard and say, I love my yard. If you'll put God in it and love God for it, amen. God wants you to have it. He said, take the good, take the sweet of the land, amen, and enjoy it, amen. He told told them to do that, he said, you don't have to weep.
Yes, bless you, Jesus.
I'm going somewhere with this, though. This is a totally different generation than us. Listen to what he told them to do, and then I want to get over to Matthew. Then he said, go your way, eat the fat and drink the sweet, and send portions to them that whom nothing is prepared. That's what we're going to do Wednesday night, ain't it? Oh, yeah. I thought at first, here's what I thought. I thought, Lord, we'll have snacks, Renee, and some food. That'd be good. We'll eat and do that. Then I thought, no. Let's not worry about us eating. We do that all the time. Let's worry about feeding somebody else this time. Amen. Let's worry about them. That way we won't have to clean up a mess either. Listen. Send portion unto them to whom nothing is prepared, for this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry. Listen to this. For the joy of the Lord is your strength. Say amen. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Brown, that's when we ought to raise our hands. That's when we ought to say amen, amen. That's when we ought to put our heads to the ground and worship God. I got up to preach this scripture one night. I hadn't been preaching very long. I was up in a little assembly of God church, and then people, they'd want me to preach, and I'd try to preach, and they'd root me on for a minute, and I'd lock up. And I'd say, the joy of the Lord is our strength, because, and I'd get there, and I couldn't preach a lick. Miss Libby, it would hit me right back in the face, everything I said. I was going through a battle. I mean, we were struggling at home, and Miss Reba, I'd try to preach, and I'd say, the joy of the Lord is our strength, and I couldn't think of nothing to even say about the joy of the Lord. I mean, I was dragging. I was down. And I would try to preach on that. We stopped service 3 times and they prayed for me.
Amen. Bless you, Lord.
That's hard to preach when you got 15 of them, that saints that's been in it for 100 years, said, oh, bless him, help him, Lord. And they was doing it because they felt sorry for me. And I was trying to tell them about the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is your strength, though. Did you know that? If you try to live to the law, you'll die. If you worry about everything that's going on in the world, you'll die. If you depend on your happiness coming from the government and the changes that are made, you'll die, because they will let you down. But the joy of the Lord is the Spirit of the Lord. It's not a physical strength. It's a spiritual strength. I'd like to go back there one of these days. I preached there every Sunday night. Them people were so good to me. I preached there every Sunday night for about 2 years. They helped me a whole lot. You ain't got to be a Baptist to go to heaven. Do you know that? I'm glad, ain't you? He said, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. I'm going to get back to that in a minute, but I want to move on here. So the Levites stilled all the people, said, hold your peace, for the day is holy, neither be ye grieved. And all the people went their way, and to drink, and to send portions to them, and make great mirth, because they had understood the words. Now get this. They went because they understood the words of the book. They understood the words of the preacher. They listened. How many times has your life went haywire a week after a message that was the Sunday before warned you and preached to you and helped you on something, and then it went exactly against it? You went against it. Amen? Because the words that were declared unto them, in other words, they had freedom because they listened to the Word of God. Let me go to Matthew chapter 11. Lord, help us this morning. I want you to listen. Jesus is preaching in Matthew chapter 11, and they're asking him all kinds of questions about John the Baptist. Why John doubted, why John struggled, why John had some trouble. But in verse number 16, and we'll go down to about verse number 30, I want you to listen. And compare this with what we just read. Because by chapter 13 in the book of Nehemiah, they're backslid and the house of God is forsaken. They had a revival for a little while, but revivals always come to an end, right? There's always trouble. There's always trials. But I want you to listen to these generations. How many of you think right now, let me ask you this, and how many of you think that 2024 were the most blessed generation to be able to get a hold of God in history? You can find God anywhere. There's a Bible in every room. You got a phone that's got Bible apps and preaching and it's singing and whatever you want. I got a set of earphones that I put on while I mow or weed eat or work. And James said he couldn't do it, but I can. Amen. I can listen to my music and do anything I want to do. I can listen to preaching. I can listen to the Bible. I can do any of that. I can just turn it on and it's right there. Matter of fact, I can pick a topic that I want to hear something on and it'll bring it up. Anything that I want is at my disposal. I say in 2024, we're probably one of the most blessed generations in the history of the world. We have no excuse. We have no reason. There's no way that we can say, Ron, I just didn't know. I didn't have the word in front of me. I didn't have nobody to help me. Now, you got to be careful who you listen to.
Amen. Yes.
Amen. Because you can hear whatever you want. That's why there's 100 denominations, a million of them. Because people find what they want to hear and then sign up with it. I want you to listen to what Jesus said. He said, verse number 16, but whereunto shall I liken this generation? We're the second blessed generation in history. Second. But Megan, this is the most blessed generation in history because they had the Christ Himself with them. They were the most blessed, Brian, generation in the history of the world. They have no excuse. They had Him there with them. Listen to what He said. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the market and saying unto their fellows, or calling unto their fellows and saying, we have popped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and you have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking. They say he hath a devil. And the Son of Man came eating and drinking. They say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber and a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. What's that saying? Don't it saying that John the Baptist come with a message, generation of vipers, repent and be baptized. John come with a message that was hard, that would make them weep, that would hit them right in their hearts, that would cut. Matter of fact, what got him killed was him standing on the Word of God, was him calling, listen to this. This is amazing from a pulpit or from anybody today. He called sin, sin. Are you with me this morning? Give me about 45 more minutes and we'll be done. Amen. He called sin, sin. Black and white, no gray, and it got him killed. But Jesus come preaching love, preaching hope, preaching salvation, doing miracles and signs and wonders and setting giving the blind their sight and making the deaf to hear, raising the dead. And drinking and going to their weddings and having a good time with them, even though and they hated both of them. In other words, nothing was going to satisfy them. Hear me this morning. Nothing was exactly like they wanted. And they killed both of them for it, Brown. They killed both of them. Just like the children in the marketplace. They popped. In other words, they played music. They had a dance and their friends wouldn't come play. Then they played a funeral and they mourned and they weeped, but their friends wouldn't come and mourn with them. They just didn't have time for it in that generation. But I say our generation will probably be held as accountable or more than that one, because we have the full written Word of God. We have the final copy of the Word of God. Let me read to you a little bit more and we'll go home in just a minute. Are y'all right this morning? What time is it?
12 o'clock.
It's 12 o'clock? You sure? I wish I hadn't asked. Somebody else got a watch that works. Miss Reba's quit working. Listen to the Bible. Give me a few minutes, I promise. That I'll be done. Listen to verse number 20. And he began to upbraid or scold that city, the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. In the cities that he done his miracles, done all this work, they repented not. They just refused to believe in him. They saw it. They heard it. They heard the testimonies. They saw the very works and the very good, strong hand of God, Alan. But they just believed not. Woe unto thee, Chazaron, woe unto thee, Bethesda, for if mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Listen to this. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works, listen to this shocking statement, which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom. How many of you know the story of Sodom? It would have remained until this day. If Christ would have went to Sodom, done the miracles that he done in the Bible, now stay awake for me for just a minute. If Christ had went to Sodom, done these miracles, they would have believed and still been there. But these folks that had him would not believe. It was just too easy. James, they had him in the flesh. Just like you talked about this morning, they had him and they didn't want him. But I say unto you, it should be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. America is going to be held very, very, very highly accountable. I want you to understand, the church, we're not talking about the woke. We're not talking about the left. We're not talking about another party. We're not talking about that. I'm not talking, that's not what's going to take America into judgment. It will be the house of God. It'll be the Christians and the way they live and the way they carry themselves. We are the ones that's accountable. God is not going to come here. Christ is not going to come and discipline another man's children. Amen. He is over his flock, over his children. We are the ones that are accountable. It is the church that will be judged for doing or not doing, for saying right is right and wrong is wrong, and woe unto us if we say wrong is right and right is wrong. Amen. Woe unto us if we do that. We are the ones that's accountable, though we've got to understand, amen, just like in the Bible, we have him at our very disposal. We don't have any excuses. We can't make up anything to say I didn't know, because we do know. Playing dumb works in some places, it will not work with God. Amen. You have no excuses when the Spirit of God has come in your heart to live. Amen. Amen. But I want you to listen to this right here. And this is where I want to preach for about 5 minutes and we'll go home. This is amazing that Jesus preached in such a way. This is their choice. Understand, 20 through 24, Brown is absolutely 110% their choice. Raise your hand this morning if you can hear the words I'm saying, and you hear me say, raise your hand. If you hear that, listen to the next statement. 20 through 24 is their choice. You have a choice today. The choice is yours to make. You will be the one that's held accountable for your choice. You're the one that has to answer for your choice. He does not judge this city all as one city. It'll be an individual at a time. Just like it'll be for the church, it'll be an individual at a time. They did have a choice to follow him. It was their choice to believe or not believe. They saw the miracles. Many did believe. Amen. They chose not to. But listen to this. Then he goes into this wonderful scripture. This is their choice for them. Here, if you don't hear nothing else, hear this. This is their choice for them. This is his choice for us. Right here. At that time Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent. Boy, ain't that the truth. And hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for it seemed good in thy sight, all things are delivered unto me of my Father. No man knoweth the Son, but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father, save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Now listen to these next two verses, and we'll go home. Come unto me. Here's your invitation. For you that are struggling this morning, you that are hurting this morning, you that are without this morning, you who feel like you're on the outside looking in, you who feel like that something's missing, there's a void, there's a hole, that peace is gone, that satisfaction can't be found, that there's no answer for you in your life, that you feel like something's just not there. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I. Amen. I'm glad he didn't say somebody or something. He went ahead and took that burden on himself. He said, I will give you rest. Amen. How many of you need rest? Raise your hand if you need some spiritual rest. We think of rest. We think about putting our feet in the sand. We think about kicking back. We think about shutting our eyes and maybe even sleeping. We think about a long night's sleep. We think about taking a break, not going to work. We think about doing something that we just want to do. We think about rest being like that. But honey, that's not rest at all. Some of you looking pale. Well, I don't want it, preacher. I want that other stuff you just said. Well, I do too. But I want this rest. I want the rest of God. I want the rest that rests my soul. I want the rest that's going to get me to the end. Amen. No matter how much I rest physically, I'm going to get tired again. Hallelujah. Man, I've been so tired before that I couldn't hold my eyes open. I've been so tired before, Brown, that I tell you what, one time before the Lord saved me, I was messed up on all kinds of stuff. Danny hadn't slept in probably 6-8 nights or maybe more, and I've seen shadows run everywhere. I was so strung out as a man could get. I was so tired, Denise, and I'd lay down and try to sleep, and I couldn't sleep. I was like some sort of a demon-possessed man out of the Bible. I was wandering around, hey, lost as a ball in high winds. If I'd have died that day, I would have went to hell, but I was so tired. I couldn't find no rest, couldn't find no hope, couldn't find no help, wasn't no peace, wasn't no joy, wasn't no love, wasn't nothing to do with God, amen, around me. I thought I was going to die in that shape, but I don't know. I don't even know if I could have died. Too tired to even die. You ever seen somebody that couldn't live and couldn't die? That's a bad way to be. But I've been there. Listen to me. Amen. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Lord have mercy, we need some rest. You know what rest is? It's the joy of the Lord being your strength, Miss Betty. You went a long time without sleeping one time, didn't you? Taking care of Paige. I think me and Mom went about 24 nights. Might have got 2 hours at the most. And when we did, we slept with one eye open and one hand stretched out. Because it's one of them things, Shannon, that Shannon talked about when he had his my brain problem, and one of the things when I had my heart, it was the closest probably that I'll ever be to God, unless I have to go through something like that again. Because Denise, all I done was pray. At first I started praying quiet. I'd hear someone say, Lord help us, Lord help us. I'd pray in my spirit. You ever pray in your spirit? That'll bring joy to the Lord if you pray in your spirit. The Bible said building up your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Pray in your spirit, pray with the Spirit. Amen. And finally, by the end, it's just pray out loud, Lord, help us! Help! But you know, it was so amazing right how strength would come. Every day, never took a nap. Just wake up and go. I don't know, it don't even seem humanly possible. Looking back, couldn't do it unless it was the circumstances. See, these things that you say, preacher, I can't do that. I die, I can't do that. You can't do that until you have no choice. When you have no choice to do something, that's when Scripture's like, His grace is sufficient. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He's a friend sticketh closer than a brother. All those Scriptures begin to come to life. Logos becomes Ramos. It begins to come in. You say, boy, that is true. It's right, Miss Betty. You can't work it up on a Sunday morning whenever things are going perfect. This stuff happens in trials and battles and building walls and all that stuff. Amen. But He said He wants to give you rest. And boy, some of you need it. My eyes twitching right now. I must need it. How many of you said you needed rest? Spiritual rest. Rest for your soul. We try everything to feel better. We try everything to look better. We try everything to be better. And it's, listen to this word right here, temporary. If you don't believe me, look at your picture album. Say amen. Right, Larry? Larry said, you still got a good head of hair. And I had to point out, I said, my girls remind me all the time, Larry. Every time one sits behind me. But listen. All this will wear out anyway. You're taking care of something that's going to die no matter what you do. Take my yoke upon you. And listen to this. Learn of me. Learn of me. Learn of Jesus. That stuff Kevin talked about this morning, learn that. That is Him. All the miracles, learn that. That is Him. Learn what He wants to do. Learn His heart. Read about Him. Learn of Him. Now we got to be moving on, but I want you to understand, if you'll learn of Him, you'll love Him. Amen? And the more you know about Him, the more you'll love Him. I'm done right here. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. It's the only time He ever says anything like that in the Bible. And ye shall find rest unto your souls. Rest unto your souls. Not necessarily your body. I'll go ahead and tell you. These bodies, Doug, your body ain't ever going to feel like it used to or like you want it to again. There ain't no fountain of youth. Then it ain't going to work. Ain't a pill, powder, or potion that can make a man what he once was. I don't want to be what I once was. That's not what I'm looking for, Doug. I just want to be what God wants me to be today. I want to find rest for my soul. If my soul's happy, my body will follow suit. A grieved soul, you ever seen anybody with a grieved soul? They look sick in body. Now I'm done. I know we got to go home. For my yoke is easy. How could He say such a thing? How could anything be easy like that, Brownie? He's talking about the hardest thing in the world. That's to find rest for your soul and peace and joy and all that stuff. That's the hardest thing that's ever been. Doctors' offices are full. Psychiatrists are booked up. Counselors are booked up. People trying to find rest. How could it be? How could He use such a word that's almost upsetting and insulting? That He'd say it's easy because it's faith in Him. That's too easy, preacher. Well, I'm sorry. That's just the answer. Amen? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. These bodies are going to wear out. They're going to give up on me. They're going to quit. Kevin asked this morning, how many of y'all had ever been in a room when somebody died? Raise your hand if you've been there. Man, almost everybody in here. There ain't nothing like it. I've seen it several times. Denise, when that spirit leaves the body, everything changes. Sometimes it's disturbing. Sometimes it's comforting. Listen to what Revelation 21:4 said, there'll be no more of though. This is joy of the Lord right here. This is peace. He said there'll be no more tears. There'll be no more death. Say amen. Amen. There'll be no more sorrow. Amen. There'll be no more crying. And I like this one. There shall be no more pain. The joy of the Lord will be your strength. Every time I ask Sid how he's doing, he says this right here. I'm wearing out. I'm wore out. I'm wearing out. We all are, Sid. We all are. Everybody in this congregation is wearing out right before my eyes. Right, there's a number of heartbeats that all of us has got. There's a number of breath that's all of us has got. There's a number of steps that all of us are going to take. And they'll all be different. I'm glad we don't know, ain't you? I'm glad we don't know. But the Bible says it's appointed unto every man wants to die, and after this the judgment. But we can't sit here and worry about the day we're going to die. Brother, we got to worry about today. We got to worry about this moment. We got to worry about these things that I preached about today. Oh, it just got quiet. Something cut off. What happened? Just got quiet. How many of you have been born again by the Word of God? By the Word of God. That's where the life comes from. If anything else, if you heard anything else when you think you got saved, you did not get saved. Brown, it's the Word of God. It's the Spirit of God. It's got to be this red rock. That's what made the difference. And God's people seem so tired. They seem so wore out. They seem so fatigued. James, they seem like they're run down. You know how you felt the day that you got home from working out on every light pole in the country, you and Dan and I, all y'all that worked on, you worked nonstop, didn't you? And then when you got home, you didn't know what to do. Probably so tired you couldn't rest at first, wasn't you? You might have rested, but I've been so tired I couldn't rest. I've been so tired when I lay down, I felt like there's something else I had to do and I couldn't rest. Anybody ever been there? You ever laid down, tried to rest, you're so tired you couldn't sleep because you felt like there's something else you had to do? That's where the enemy wants to keep you. That's your soul that's troubled. You ought to come this morning. He said, come unto me, not the preacher, unto Christ. If you're that way, you ought to come this morning. Ask for help with it. Amen. If you're here lost this morning, maybe you're like I was. When I said a while ago, and I don't talk about my testimony every service by no means, but when I said I was wandering around so tired, lost, pathetic drug addict, pitiful, maybe that's you this morning. You say, I'm wore out, I need help. You ought to come, because all that'll do is wear you out till you die. Amen. Lord, help us this morning. Denise, come on with a song. Lord, we love you. God, clear our thoughts right now, Lord. Get us back where we need to be. Get us on track. God, I pray you'll get people's attention to focus right now for just a few minutes. Let everybody examine herself, be honest with herself this morning, in Jesus' name. God, we love you. We need your help. Got a lot of people in this church need your help this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. Mind the Lord.